any habit, for you to change to a good habit, it takes 21 days. So persevere for 21 days and make it a good habit. And avoid procrastination, doubting yourself. You are the best. Say in your mirror, that is one of the techniques, that is the don't doubt yourself and believe in yourself. And always take care of yourself. Don't skip the step of self-care. You may think that getting up early in the morning, half an hour exercise will actually rob you of a time of studies. But if you do a half an hour of exercise and then start your studies, it will be more beneficial and yield better results than skipping that exercise and doing your prayers and then starting. So you may skip the prayers and then try to start your studies and then think that you will do it afterwards. So these all things are very important because these are part of self-care. That is, the feeding your mind is actually the prayers. Feeding yourself is with the exercise. So all these things you have to think. So one more important thing is you have to quit, especially New Year is coming. That is 2022. The resolution should be you have to quit quitting. So never give up. Never say die. Never give up. So that these are the things. So it's just 8:30 is just coming up. So I thought I'll just say these. And always, wherever you are in your life, you know, it's inadequate, that our knowledge is inadequate. This is the stuff we know, stuff we don't know that you don't know. And the stuff the entire universe constitutes is much more. So nobody is perfect. Nobody is a knowledgeable, perfect encyclopedia. So you have a lot to learn. So go ahead with a positive mind. So with that, we'll start the recall session. The recall session is kind of like, it's not the entire questions which I'm taking. I had my students, Chinmay, Pushkar, and Yamini, who had helped me compile through a few of the questions. So with their help, I had found out the answers. So it is not the exact stem may not be the correct one, but I had tried to give the perfect answer by looking at the textbook for these questions, which I had got. So these questions are important, not because it's a past exam, it has gone over. So these questions are very important because the examiners have taken questions from very important parts of the neurology aspect. And these are very important portions. And the next upcoming exams, these portions or in and out these portions could likely to be repeated. So these are very high yield areas. So read in and around these portions. So first is a question from movement disorders, that is regarding a hyperkinetic movement disorder. So can I have the poll option, please? Poll option. It was there just a moment before. So meanwhile, yes, polls have come. Yes. Okay. I'll launch the polls. So this question, which one of the following is a complex tics? So as we are talking, it's a tic is actually a hyperkinetic movement disorder. So whether it's a simple tic or a complex tic. So first we have to know what a tic is. Then we have to process which is a complex tic and which one is a simple tic. So most of them have answered, about 55% have answered it as handshaking is a complex tic, grimacing, shoulder shrugging and sniffing are actually simple tics. So let's see how you will come up with an answer to this question. Okay, so is there an easy way? First of all, the answer is handshaking. So definitely any movement disorder coming to you, if you see the fine neurophilia module on movement disorder, we have divided as hypokinetic and hyperkinetic. Hypokinetic, the most common is the Parkinsonism. Hyperkinetic is the one you have to be aware of because you have to differentiate it as tremor, chorea, athetosis, myoclonus, dystonia, and balismus. And also differentiate it from mimics like stereotypies. So tics are like stereotypy intermittent movements, which could be either a motor one or a phonic tic, which has an abrupt onset. And it is typical feature, it's arrhythmic. If it becomes rhythmic and oscillatory, we call it as tremor. And it is kind of a rapid, and it is suppressible. That is, the suppressibility by will is actually one of the characteristic feature of tic. So how to differentiate a simple from a complex tic? Simple tic are much slower, brief, and kind of a meaningless kind of action. So that include, that's how one easy way of differentiating a complex from a simple tic. So handshaking, you know that handshaking is a meaningful action. So that's how we can differentiate it from a complex from a simple tic. And facial, high blinking, eye movements, nose twitching, grimacing, opening eyes, etc., shoulder shrugging, etc., are simple tics. One mistake in this column is head shaking is actually included under this thing, simple tic and not a complex tic. That is one mistake written in this table I wanted to point out. So handshaking is a purposeful complex tic. So one which is meaningless is simple one. A meaningful action, purposeful one action is a complex one. So which of the following is involved in following neurotransmitter is involved in the mesolimbic pathway? So what do you think is the neurotransmitter involved in the mesolimbic pathway? So I launch the poll. Yes, pretty easy question. All should attempt, because it's not for the past exam we are doing this exercise. It's for the upcoming exam. So not to make any mistake. Even if you make mistake, you make mistake here now during this exercise. Okay, most of them have answered it correctly. That is, it is the dopamine. So we have gone through this during this session on movement disorders, we had gone through this. That is, these habits are actually dopamine driven feedback loops. So these are, the colin is from the nucleus basalis, norepinephrine from the locus coeruleus, serotonin from raphe, midline raphe nucleus, and dopamine from the substantia nigra. So are there other pathways for dopamine? Yes, that is, they have mesolimbic, mesocortical, nigrosatal, and tuberohypophyseal are the other pathways which are involved, which are having dopamine as the neurotransmitter. So which of the following is false regarding thrombolysis? So this question, try to answer this. False regarding thrombolysis. So are we using thrombolysis for stroke thrombolysis? Definitely we are using, especially in India. That is a definite answer. So since 2016, we are using tenecteis for stroke thrombolysis. And thrombolysis can be done safely if there are 1 to 10 cortical microbleeds. What are these cortical microbleeds, which we'll see? When an acute stroke patient comes to us, if you are asked to do only one investigation, which is the investigation which we'll do? Is it the ECG? Is it the PT, INR, or APTT which we will do? Or is it something else? And what is the normal BP below which, a cutoff of BP below which we can safely do a thrombolysis? So that is the option. So which is the false statement? So the false statement, I have modified the question a bit because that is the stem I got. Yes, most of them have mixed answers. I'll tell you how. So the first answer is the wrong one. Tenecteplase is approved in India from 2016. And in our hospital, while I was doing my thesis, that is regarding thrombolysis versus thrombectomy. That was my thesis. So when I started with, it was Alteplase, which was the drug which was used. So alteplase, you know, the dosage given is 0.9 milligram per kg. First, we give an initial bolus, then we wait for 1 hour. So some of the problem is that we have to give an infusion pump. So some stroke patients, what we do is that after we give the thrombolysis, start the thrombolysis, sometimes we have this infusion pump may not be working. So some issues that could happen. So I live in a center which is, I am working in a center which is actually in a very poor area. And you know, alteplase, though the cost is very high. And it could cost even the cost of one vial is actually 48. Some patients, obese patients, we may need 2 vials. So it will escalate to about double the price. But tenecteplase, then 20 milligram vial, is actually costing only 28,900 rupees. So when this drug came, and also you know need to know that tenecteplase only a single bolus, 5 seconds you need to push the drug. So because we have a stroke center, we are doing thrombectomy, we push the drug, and we can send take the patient to cath lab immediately. That is the importance of using a tenecteplase, which is a more fibrin specific drug and has a rapid action, which is cost effective. So when this drug, it was came in 2016, it was approved by DCGA, Drug Control General of India, and not by FDA. So that is the wrong statement here. And thrombolysis, microbleeds, if you find it there, is it safe? Yes, according to the AHA 2018 guidelines, if you have less than 10 microbleeds in the subtraction susceptibly weighted imaging, you can safely go ahead with the thrombolysis. But if there is more than 10, even then you can go for thrombolysis, but there is chance for a symptomatic intracranial hemorrhage in those patients. And if you are given to do only one investigation, that investigation is actually glucose. If glucose less than 50, there is high chance that one, it is a stroke mimic. Second, that there is high risk of complications following thrombolysis in case of a hypoglycemia in a stroke patients. And BP also, you have the cutoff is 185 bar 110. And further, we have to keep the BP at the range of 180 bar 105 in a post-thrombolysis stroke patient. So these all things are very important. This question is not important right now. This is over. But these are the things which could be the future MCQs for you. So tenecteplase is DCGA approved in 2016, not FDA approved. And all the things I have told is that this is from the AHA guidelines. There's a wonderful slide in Google. You can go through that. AHA 2018 guidelines have been completely. So every interview, every class, everything, every MCQ exam or anything I attend, I read that slide. I go through that slide before going there. So everything is clearly written in that slide, if you see. So cortical microbleeds, as I was saying, it's actually 1 to 10 can reasonably go for thrombolysis. But more than 10, there is increased risk of symptomatic intracranial hemorrhage. And what are these cortical microbleeds in a normal patient? That they could be found, especially in susceptibly weighted image, SWA image. So if they are found in this basal ganglia, thalamic, and brainstem and cerebellum, that is deep areas, they could be a result of hypertensive vasculopathy. But if they are found in the cortical, superficial, subcortical regions, then they could be a cause of that, they could be a result of a cerebral amyloid angiopathy. The question which has been repeated multiple times is that which is the most common site of bleed in a case of a CAA, cerebral amyloid angiopathy, is which lobe? It is the occipital lobe. So which of the following is false regarding erenumab? So in headache module, I have extensively talked regarding this. So all these questions, if you see, has been covered in all the modules of neurophilia. Yes, they have. Yes, just try to attempt so that I can see how it's going for you all. Those who have not given the NEET SS, the INESS also can give it, give an attempt. This is kind of a sure question. Means something related to these maps. These maps are upcoming things in case of migraine. If not migraine, any map which is upcoming, like the latest inventions or latest developments in the field of neurology, could be an upcoming question, could be a question in the upcoming NEET exam. So some has doubt whether what is the CGRP, calcitonin gene related peptide. So it is a peptide protein. It has to bind to a receptor to cause some effect. That is the one thing. So where does all these MAPs, Japans, and sumatriptan, everything, triptans all act? That we have to understand first. So whether it is a CGRP receptor antagonist, we'll have to see. Metabolization, that pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics part is very difficult for you. So it's a tricky question. So only if you know deep into this drug molecule, we'll be able to answer the question. So the answer, the false part is, it is not metabolized by CYP molecules, because Japans are the ones, Japans, that is the Remi Japan, Ubro Japan, etc., are the ones which are more metabolized by these. And that is why when you have a metabolization by these cytochromes, that is the point when we have increased drug-drug interactions. And when we don't have these metabolization part by the cytochromes are not skipped or escaped, then we don't have drug-drug interactions. That is one of the advantage of this ERENUMAB. That is, it is not metabolized by these cytochromes. But Japan's, that is Ubro Japan, Remi Japan, etc., are metabolized by the cytochrome P450 and the C3A4. That is the reason why they have increased drug-drug interactions. So these are the basic drugs in case of migraine. And you should understand that this drugs acting on CGRP receptor could be a question. So odd man out or the different ways these questions could come. So CGRP is a peptide. So if you block that peptide, that round, small P-like things, that is a peptide. The blockade of the peptide with an monoclonal antibody is all those other MAPs which we have in this one side. I'll take the pen. So these ones, the eptinezumab, fremanezumab, galcanezumab are the peptide acting drugs. So they act on these peptides. So they have marked rightly here two. These are the ones, peptides. So one which acts on the receptor is actually the block, which blocks the receptor are the ERENUMAB and the Japans. So Japans directly acts, blocks the receptor. And this ERENUMAB, what is the difference from the Japan? It is actually a monoclonal antibody which acts on the receptor. So this is the another one, another picture to show that. So keep these pictures in mind. So directly antagonizes receptor is the Japan's. Antagonizes with the help of a monoclonal antibody is ERENUMAB. And which acts on the ligand, that is the peptide, is the galcanezumab, eptinezumab, and fremanezumab. So these are the differences. So first, if you understand this fact, then it will be very easy. Definitely, these are also MCQ worth. So these are actually monthly injections which we give. Monthly injections, and most are subcutaneous injections. And what are the difference between Japans and monoclonal antibodies, which we were talking about? These Japans are used for abortive treatment, most of them. And monoclonal antibodies, most likely, it is not cut and right rule, but most likely are used for preventive treatment. And it causes hypertension, is a fully humanized antibody, and this was the first CGRP approved by FDA. And it has two doses, 70 milligram and 140 milligram, given as a subcutaneous injections. So Japan metabolized by CYP3A4 and hence are subjected to what you call the drug-drug interactions. So that is very important in case of Japan's, because those drugs sharing the same metabolic pathway will be affected. So these Japan's are notorious to have drug-drug interactions, which won't be there in case of ERENUMAB, which has a different drug metabolizing pathway. Now, this is an age-old question. You can, HP has raised the hand. You can put that in the chat box. Option was given as hypertension is a side effect, sir. Okay, fine. Okay, let's see. Okay, next question is Nusrnesen. This is an age-old question. So, but the importance is that if some questions regarding SMA or any of the options given are there, you should be able to answer that. So, Nusrnesen, I am pretty sure that nobody would have made any mistake in answering this. But even then, I want everyone to answer this question. Nusrnesen is used in. Is it progressive muscular atrophy, spinal muscular atrophy, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, or Duchenne muscular dystrophy? Yes, you know the hues and cries regarding this drug, not this drug, the newer drugs, that is Zolgensma, which is the costliest drug, then the Risdilpam. So many drugs are there for SMA. So yes, most of them have answered. Nobody has gone wrong in this question. So it is SMA, spinal muscular, much repeated question. So it's otherwise called Spinraza. So a study regarding Nusrnesen, SMN1 and SMN2 gene. And regarding ALS, what are the criteria you know about the diagnosis of ALS? Can somebody put in the chat box regarding the criteria for amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, which we used to use? So meanwhile, you can see what is happening here. L-Escorial, very good. Yes, yes. L-Escorial criteria and AVAGI criteria and L-Escorial criteria. But the latest one is Gold Cross criteria. It's a place in Australia where this conference was done, had taken place. And this is the latest criteria for diagnosis of ALS. You keep in mind, you can read through. I cannot have a limitation of time, so I won't go into details. But you can read through by looking into the video again or go through it. So these drugs, I'll name the drugs. And you put in the chat box which disease I'm talking about. Edaviron, Rilutek, that is Riluzole, Tiglutek, that is the thickened Riluzole, and Exervan, that is the Riluzole oral film. Because you know this ALS patients would have difficulty swallowing because they have so pseudobulbar effect and all. So in that case, that is why these drugs, the same Riluzole has been made into a thickened form. Same Riluzole have been made into an oral film. And one more drug you should know is Nudaxta, which I have talked in my MND module, that is dextromethorphan with quinidine sulfate. So my two questions would be, already I had answered one. These are the drugs used in what? These are the drugs used in ALS. But what is the indication for Nudaxta? What does it what does it change in case of ALS? Yes, Sumita and Prince have answered. It's actually the pseudobulbar effect, which is relieved with Nudaxta. It is a combination of dextromethorphan and quinidine sulfate. So Nusrnesen is an antisense oligonucleotide. Risdilpam is a small molecule splicing modifier. And Zolgensma, you have to understand, it is actually carried by adeno-associated virus 9. It is a kind of a gene therapy which deliver a copy of SMN1 gene to encode for the human SMN protein. It's a kind of a gene therapy which is being utilized. You know the cost. It's one of the costliest drug in medicine, not alone neurology, it's including medicine. So this is, and these drugs, what do you think? So in February 2021, one more drug was approved for this disease. So other drugs which were previously approved were deflazacort, eplerenone, ataluren, etiplersen, etc., etc. Can you, yes, Pratik has answered Gayatri. Gayatri, it's not myotonic dystrophy. Sumita has answered, HP has answered, yes. Neha, yes. It is DMD, definitely. So keep this in mind, February 2021, Amondys 45, otherwise called casimersen injection for specifically exon 45 skipping. Just keep in mind, this is the newest change which has happened to DMD medications. So keep that in mind. So it is in DMD. So which of the following is true regarding a lateral medullary syndrome? Pretty easy question. I don't know whether the options, how it was and all. Somebody has, so I made a question for myself so that, So can anybody put in the chat box what was the actual question? Was it regarding, so it's pretty easy. I think there shouldn't be much confusion. Was there anything confusing part to this MCQ? Okay, no honors, that's fine. But was there anything confusing to this MCQ question which was given in the exam? Downbeat nystagmus was an option. Are you sure? Okay. So downbeat nystagmus. Okay. Actually, there will be ipsipulsion, contrapulsion. There will be opposite side nystagmus. Okay. Okay. Now downbeat nystagmus was there. Usually you don't find downbeat nystagmus because it's kind of a horizontal nystagmus with usually we find. Yes, the answer is, the true thing is actually the because of the sympathetic system is occurring in the ipsilateral side, it is actually the Horner's syndrome in the ipsilateral part which is affected. Rest, you have to understand the, so ipsilateral Horner's, so you know the medulla. So all these you can read by yourself. So one thing wrong was sympathetic tract, ipsilateral, and hiccups. So continuous hiccups occurring without any break is otherwise called singultus, which is a characteristic finding in case of a lateral medullary syndrome. So which of the following acts by inhibiting GABA transaminases? So you know the GABA, and which is acting, which is the drug which specifically acts as a GABA transaminase inhibitor. So question number 7. I think we have to speed up. Yes, it's a pretty simple one. Gabapentin, what made you think it's gabapentin? I'll tell you. We have been studying from MPBS, I think, because pharmacology, I remember it's written in Sparsh Gupta, the book, MCQ book, regarding how to remember this as a mnemonic, vigabatrin. Vigabatrin is the drug. So VI for visual field defect. GABA transaminase inhibitor, TRIN. And it, definitely you can remember it's used for infantile spasm. So other drugs acting on GABA, benzodiazepine definitely, barbiturates, vigabatrin, tiagabin. But tiagabin is inhibition of GABA uptake. So that is the one. Which of the following is known as a familial, that is myasthenia with recurrent apnea? So this, we had talked in the neuromuscular junction module extensively of the congenital myasthenia syndromes which act in the presynaptic, synaptic, as well as the postsynaptic membrane. So in that, there is a high yield table in Harrison, a very high yield table in Harrison. I had told you during that module that question would definitely come. Some mutations would be there definitely in the exams, future exams, if you remember. Neuromuscular junction module. Yes, definitely. So what is the drug of choice in DOX7 mutation? Can somebody write in the chat box? Drug of choice in DOX7 mutation. Yes, albuterol or salbutamol. Both could be useful. Very good. So these are drugs which are there in our hands for asthma treatment and all. No? So we can give a trial of these if we suspect these kind of diseases before going for genetic testing. So that is the beauty of neurology. So yes, it's CHAD mutation. So it's a presynaptic one. So presynaptic is very less. Very few are presynaptic. So remember that CHAD mutation, CHAT mutations. So this was the table I had discussed during that module. So postsynaptic is acetylcholine receptor. That is different, ACHR. You know, receptors are postsynaptic. So remember all the receptors. If in the option receptor, you can logically roll out the receptors. Then synaptic esterase deficiency. That's so esterase will be in the neuromuscular junction, na? Synaptic region. So that is different. So with paucity of ACH releases, CHAT. So that is one. So this table from Harrison in table 442, definitely if some more questions would come in the NEET exam, definitely. So read that too. And these two involving abnormal clustering. So, you know, this clustering also is important. You definitely have to go back and I don't know whether you have time to go through the entire module, at least some part of the module on neuromuscular junction. I think it will be definitely two questions, one or two questions will be there in the upcoming meet regarding that. So which of the following is a wrong match? If you have the same question as I think has come, then it's kind of a repeat for the same exam, one repeat has come. So it's very easy for you. You have ruled out one. You have made out that aranumab is for migraine. Risdilpam, I have already spoken. Then ocrelizumab is the drug of choice for which type of myasthenia, which of type of MS? Is it prior, relaxed? Yes, PPM is very good, very good. Okay, the wrong answer. You know, aducanumab was recently approved for treatment for dementia, that is in Alzheimer's disease. So it's in Alzheimer's disease, 170 milligram. So what is false regarding mechanical thrombectomy? You can try to give the answer for this one. Mechanical thrombectomy, 10th question. Yeah, it's a pretty straightforward question. Yes, definitely it can be used for M1 occlusion. M1 is a large vessel occlusion. We consider M1 as a large vessel occlusion. We take the device through the femoral route, go to the occluded area, catch the clot, either through a stent retriever. Previously, first used stent retriever was called Mercy. Now we use either a devices called Solitaire or Trevo. Solitaire or Trevo. Now, also in our hospital, we use some method called thromboaspiration. We aspirate the clot en bloc. We try to aspirate the clot. Now they have technique that is, one is stent retriever. Use a stent, engulf the clot in that and pulled out the clot. Or we suck the clot. That is using the aspiration technique. Now they have come up with the technique where you do both. Suck as well as trap the clot. Both are there. That is called Solumbra technique. Just for your information, I just said this. M1 occlusion aspects 6 can be patient. So what is the cutoff? A patient coming with stroke, the patient's INR is, so a certain cutoff should be there before we think the patient can be thrombolized. What is the cutoff? Cutoff for thrombolysis in a patient taking warfarin, the INR cutoff. Can anybody write in the chat box? Somebody has written? Yes, very good. 1.7. Very good. So that could be a question also. So it can be used beyond 4.5 hours. That is the data we get from the recent trials. That is the DAWN trial. I remember as DAWN, it is a new DAWN to diffuse the nihilism for thrombectomy beyond 6 hours. So which one of the following is not present in NPH? NPH, normal pressure hydrocephalus, or Adam Hakim's disease. Why is it called Adam Hakim's disease? Question number 11. Because they were the ones who first described the methods to easily identify the disease or differentiate it from other. So Adam Hakim's triad. So callosal angle is the one could be, if it is obtuse, it points towards atrophy. Crowding at apex definitely suggests generalized enlargement of sulci, suggests more of a atrophy rather than a NPH. So if it is disproportionate, if it is, there is a disproportionate enlargement of the subarachnoid space or the sulci, if there is a disproportionate enlargement, then we think it is actually NPH. If there is a diffuse or a generalized enlargement, it points more towards a atrophy or a generalized atrophy. So that is one point. So Evan syndex, widening of temporal horn, that is roundening also, there is capping, acute callosal angle less than 90 degree, we'll see, and upward bowing in the coronal section, in the sagittal section, if you see, there will be upward bowing of the callosal, corpus callosum. In the coronal section, this section is the coronal section, then you can see the callosal angle. If it is obtuse, we have the, it is due to the multi-infarct state or atrophy. Otherwise, if it is acute, we think of this thing. And what we are talking previously was DESH, disproportionate enlargement of Sylvian fissure or Sylvian sulcus, is actually a feature of NPH, in which there will be crowding at the, that is, there will be no increased atrophy at the frontal region, but there will be disproportionate temporal horn dilatation or Sylvian fissure dilatation. So this is the Evans index. This was asked in the previous entrance, I guess, how you calculate the Evans index. Then comes the subcalosal angle. So this is actually the acute angle which suggests NPH, and this suggests atrophy or degenerative brain disease. And this was what I was talking about. There is crowding at the apex, and there is disproportionate enlargement of the Sylvian region. So this is not generalized sulcal enlargement, but a disproportionate enlargement. So that is the one thing. So HP has raised the hand. He can write, sir, options, attenuated transependymal flow. I have to look it up, transependymal flow. So rest of the options, okay, I'll look it up. You can message me in my Telegram regarding that. So which of the following is an interictal finding in an EEG of infantile spasm? Question number 12. So you are all aware of West syndrome, otherwise called infantile spasm, Salam seizures, Salam attacks. So they are, if in the question it was interictal EEG finding, then the answer would be different. If it was an ictal EEG finding, the answer would be different. So slow waves followed by electrode decremental response is actually a finding in during the ictal phase of infantile spasm. So you know, during interictal phase, the typical finding in a West syndrome or infantile spasm is what we classically say as hips arrhythmia. So interictal, that is between the seizures, if you take an EEG, the classical finding is what is called a hips arrhythmia pattern, which you see. So listen to me carefully. Hips arrhythmia is the most common interictal EEG pattern associated with infantile spasm. And what is that? And I'll tell you, slow waves followed by electrode decremental response are a feature of ictal EEG, that is during the spasms. So in between spasm, it is actually hips arrhythmia. So if in the question it was an interictal or a non-ictal EEG, then the best answer is slow waves, because hips arrhythmia is the characteristic interictal EEG pattern. So this is actually the ictal. Ictal will be having the electrode decremental response, and interictal will be having the slow waves. With the slow waves doesn't mean that it is just slow, it will be having high voltage. Slow ones will be having high voltage. That is the characteristic finding in hips arrhythmia. That is for an interictal period. So it depends on the stem of the question. If it is ictal, then the first option would be the right one. If it is interictal, then hips arrhythmia, if that was the option, then nobody has a doubt. But interictal equal hips arrhythmia equal to diffuse slow waves. If electrode decremental, it means it is an ictal EEG. That's what I feel, or that is likely to be a right answer. It's kind of deep question. You have to know deep regarding this. So hope this explanation is clear for you. So these are further regarding that. So child presented initially with febrile seizures, which were hemiclonic seizures. Later had neurocognitive decline, other seizures, other varieties. What is the likely gene mutated in this patient? So try to answer this. Yeah, everyone has no doubt. This is a classical finding seen in Dravet syndrome. So Dravet syndrome has the mutation in SCN1A most commonly. So drug resistant epilepsy, otherwise called vaccine encephalopathy, because it usually started in children when the vaccine was given and the patient developed fever, and following the fever, it started as a febrile seizures, febrile encephalopathy to begin with, and later became. So there is a spectrum of CN1A, that is sodium channel disorders. That is, you have to, so it's kind of like thought of as a spectrum. So familial hemiplegic migraines, some types comes under the spectrum to Dravet syndrome. So a 30-year-old female presented with acute onset of visual loss in both eyes over 7 days. Her fundus findings were shown below. What do you think is the pathology? That is, what is the most likely cause for this? So that was the stem I got. So I threaded a question from it. Was it demyelinating glaucomatous with optic atrophy? So there is no optic atrophy in this picture, right? Not severe pale disc and all. No severe papilledema, but there is infarction-like thing here. Subhyaloid hemorrhage cannot be found out. So this is a kind of an optic neuritis which you are seeing, which is characteristically due to a demyelinating pathology. So most common pathology for optic neuritis is actually a demyelinating disorder. Which of the following does not supply bladder? A quite obvious basic anatomy question. So I think all would be answering rightly for this question. Nervae erigente, pelvic nerve, ilioinguinal nerve, pudendal nerve, or so. Yes, so it's pretty clear, pretty easy if you know it's anatomy question for you. So this is actually the ilioinguinal nerve. Okay, so that is easy. Okay, sign, I have in my neuropathy module, I have shown the patient video. I couldn't retrieve it today to be shown to you. Okay, sign, is this the usual okay? You have perfect round. When there is okay problem, there is, you cannot properly do an okay, then it is called okay sign. It is seen in anterior ischemic, anterior interosseous nerve neuropathy. So this is one more thing. So which one of the following is a MAO-B inhibitor? Which one of the following is a MAO-B inhibitor? Question number 17. That is not there. Okay, fine. So you know the answer for that? Somebody put in the chat box, MAO-B inhibitor. Cefenamide. So what are entocapone and opicapone? What are they? Complements. Yes, correct. So answer is safinamide. Safinamide, you have to understand that it has got multiple actions. It has got pleiotropy effect. It is actually majorly a MAO-B inhibitor, but it has got multiple actions. And yes. So next question is, which of the following is false regarding scar? So that I'll launch the poll. I hope these were the options. Yes, SCAR 7. So SCAR was classified as 4 types by whom? Anybody know SCAR classification of ataxias were done into 4 by whom? Anita Harding. Anita Harding is a lady who had classified ADCA, autosomal dominant ataxias syndromes. So SCAR 2, you know, it is otherwise, one variant is called Vadia syndrome, Noshir Vadia, NH Vadia, a great teacher in neurology. So under his name is the Vadia syndrome, SCAR 2, where there is close circuits. SCAR 3 is Machado-Joseph disease. SCAR 7 has got retinal pigmented dystrophy, which is correctly written in the 4th option. So where does this basal ganglia classification and all come in? It's in SCAR 20. SCAR 20 has the calcifications. Very good. Sam has correctly said that. So next question is, which of the following is used to assess TIR risk? So this, I'm sure, all must have answered it rightly, because we, in the stroke module, we had done exercise regarding this also. Okay, yes. So what is has blood score used for? The name itself says that. So yes, excellent. So ABCD score, which you can see. What is false regarding SSP? That is subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. What do you think is false regarding this? Question number 20. Yes, short interval periodic discharges are seen in case of CJD. Yes, in case of Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. So, and not in case of SSP. But you have to understand one thing. In case of SSP, as time goes on, the complexes can become narrow. As time goes on, the complexes can become narrow. The classification of staging, there is a classification based on EEG, based on clinical findings, based on the slow myoclonus. The patient would be having a slow myoclonus. So that is otherwise called Jabout's classification. And what is that the EEG finding, you can keep in mind, it is called Rademacher complex. The EEG finding is called that complex, repetitive complexes, which comes in a periodic fashion, is called Rademacher complex. So it is seen in CJD, has the short interval complexes. These are regarding plets, much deeper. So other conditions where we get long interval complexes, the prototype is SSP. Then others are anoxic encephalopathy, metabolic encephalopathy, some drugs, and infectious mononucleosis. So which is true regarding AION, that is acute ischemic optic neuropathy? Question number 21. So do you think it has... Answer. Give answers. Anterior ischemic optic neuropathy. Oh, okay. Which is true regarding AION? Did I mix it up? Okay. Visual field defect actually is in the vertical meridian. That is true. And so when an optic nerve head has been rendered vulnerable to ischemia by various predisposing factors, nocturnal hypotension acts as the last straw to produce ischemia and AON. So that is one true thing. So, and anterior ischemic is actually invariably caused by giant cell arteritis, although rarely by other types of vasculitis may also cause it. And oral steroids are of no or little use in case of non-arthritic anterior ischemic optic neuropathy, that is NIAON. So altitudinal visual field defects, which involves loss of visual sensation in the horizontal half of visual field, is caused mainly by AON. So going back to the question, actually true, first one, it is actually horizontal. The visual field defects will be a defect crossing a horizontal field defect. And vasculitis, it's actually GCA, giant cell arteritis, and less likely to be vasculitis. And very less response to steroids. And nocturnal hypotension is actually a risk factor. That is the right answer here in case. This I searched and found out. So which is false regarding McDonald's 2007 criteria? This same question I had put in my module also. So CSF OCBs can be used. That is the one of the important things, which is very important in the clinical practice. So we have a lesion. We have to make sure, we have to decide whether the patient should be started on this disease modifying therapy. then what are we supposed to do? We have to wait for our next disease to occur, next insult to occur, that is next hit to occur. No, we can actually go for a CSF OCBs and then prove that it is actually dissemination in time. That is one thing. So which is false? You are asking for a false one. So brainstem and spinal cord lesion definitely can be used. It's very important. And now the extracortical, previously cortical was not included, but now with the high resolution 3 Tesla, 7 Tesla, etc. MRIs, they have proved that cortical and extracortical are in, can be interchangeably used. So that is the answer. So second one is the wrong option among this. So this is the revised 2017 criteria. You can just go through. So this, you know, a patient with HIV with biparietal occipital lesions, non-enhancing, what is your diagnosis? So definitely bilateral symmetrical lesions, there is no, and no, in the question, nothing has been told about any TB meningitis, like tuberculomas, neither enhancement or meningeal enhancement, nothing has been suggested. So TB meningitis is out of picture, you can rule out. No history suggestive of cryptococcosis, no eccentric target sign suggestive of toxoplasmosis. So definitely PMLE is up in the cards. So how to differentiate it? It is usually there will be bilateral, symmetrical, parietal lobe involvement. There will be no enhancement. There will be patchy area of peripheral diffusion restriction in case. So it can, it is, so that bilaterality is suggestive of a demyelinating kind of in disease rather than an infective kind of disease. And this is one sign called barbell sign, where you can see the lesion here, it has crossed here. So it has, it is the two big dumbbell part of a barbell. Barbell is used to lift the weight, right? So this is a barbell sign. This is otherwise called Milky Way sign, where there are punctate lesions, punctate hyperintensities in case of PMLE. Progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy caused by JC virus, that is John Cunningham virus. A 2-year-old male child with neurocognitive decline, multiple seizure. He has atonic seizures followed by jerky movements. What is your diagnosis? So since the atonic thing was given in the stem as a major thing, there is no doubt that it is what you can write. I just want to see how you answer. 2-year-old male child. Yes. Some have answered it as Lennox Gastaut syndrome. I doubt whether the question stem was different, because I also doubt because induced syndrome, rather than the neurocognitive part, they won't emphasize on the neurocognitive decline. If neurocognitive decline is the emphasis given, it could be even LGS, Lennox Gastaut syndrome. They can have multiple seizure type, including this atonic part. So that is one issue in this question sum. But if there is significant emphasis on atonic seizures, you know, the Duse syndrome is otherwise called atonic esteatic kind of seizures, myoclonic esteatic kind of seizures. So generalized idiopathic epilepsy, and the age group just fits in, that is 2 to 5 years. So same is for LGS also. So, but the neurocognitive decline is actually a characteristic, more characteristic of LGS rather than for Duse syndrome. Myoclonic esteatic epilepsy, otherwise called the Duse syndrome. All the following are true about optic nerve drusen. So any patient with papilledema, we have to also think whether it is kind of a pseudo-papilledema we are looking at. So pseudo-papilledema, one of the causes is actually a optic nerve drusen, which could mimic a papilledema. So that we have to see. So what have you written? Whether options were the same, I don't, not sure. I could just retrieve one sentence or two sentence from students. So yes, patients won't have complete loss of vision. There could be visual field defect, just like in a glaucoma. That is true. But complete loss of vision is less likely in case of an optic nerve drusen. And it is actually abnormal collection of protein and calcium. And nasal margin is the one which is most likely to be affected in case of an optic nerve drusen. So next question is, so these you can see signs of it, Drusen and all we can read. So I'll keep it for some time so we can read that. So which of the following? So if you remember this question was asked in last AIIMS. Two questions were asked from this same table. Two questions. So answer this. Two questions in the same exam were asked in the last AIIMS. So I emphasized that this is table is very important to you. So those who haven't missed the table would have definitely answered. Otherwise, it's very difficult to answer from your knowledge because it's table-based question. Yes, asymptomatic carotid stenosis is definitely actually, it's not like no risk factor. It has got risk factor in case of this. So that is the wrong option. It has got relative risk is 2. And with the risk reduction, the treatment is actually 53%. So very many trials like AC, asymptomatic carotid surgery trial, asymptomatic carotid stenosis trial. So many ACST2 trial, ACES trial, etc. are going on. So that is importance of asymptomatic carotid stenosis trial. And we are doing stenting in our hospital with very many stents to treat symptomatic carotid stenosis. We are not justified in doing an asymptomatic carotid stenosis. So a patient having a stroke with stenosis more than 70%, we do carotid stenting. That is elective carotid stenting, not an acute stenting, elective stenting. So this is my website. So I think this was also useful. So out of the 80 questions, we have recollected with the almost 50-52 questions. So rest would be more of a medicine type of questions. Neurology part, I think this INESS we have recalled. So emphasize more on in and around these subjects. So you now know which all subjects parts to emphasize in case of neurology. So this all will be most likely repeated. So emphasize. So all the best to all of you. So work hard. Don't give up. Don't give up. So make a timetable, just 18 days. This is crucial. Don't give up. Study hard. All the best to all of you. Thank you.